Hi Laura, it's great to see you.
Hi Chandra Lake, it's great to see you again too.
So I wanted to start out by actually asking you for your full name and also tell me something about, you know, your professional affiliations, what you do, and a little bit about your research.
Well, that should take about 5 seconds. No. So my name is Laura Helen Greene, and I'm at the National High Magnetic Field Laboratory, which is in Tallahassee, University of Florida in Los Alamos. And I'm also a professor at Florida State University. And just having a great time being the chief scientist there, trying to bring together all the user facilities. And it's an exciting, broad place to work. And I think a real center of condensed matter and other kinds of physics and science there. My own research is in correlated electron physics. So the most common one that people know about are high temperature superconductors. And that is a problem that is probably about 30 some years old now, but the real beginning of correlated electrons is more like 60 or 70 years old. And what happens is electrons tend to go into states that people don't understand. And there's many of these problems. One of the ones that we do understand are simple superconductors, but these kind of strange states where electrons will form clumps or stripes or behave with heavy masses remain some of the great unsolved problems. And it's exciting that so many new techniques have been developed over the past few years that I think we're really getting to crack this long-standing unsolved problem.
Yeah, I really hope that it gets solved soon. So, you know, we were wondering, like, if, I mean, I was wondering in particular, how did you come here? You know, what has been the
Did you become a physicist?
Did you get inspired? Yeah. Did you get inspired by one thing? Or did you have some teachers who inspired you? Parents?
It goes way back. I think women of my age group, I think we're kind of born this way. There was no one there to inspire us. There was no one there to tell us to major in this or whatever. It was sort of like at a very young age. I mean, barely walking, I remember just being absolutely fascinated with why is water wet and the sink hard? And just these questions I didn't know how to answer. And it also helped that there was the space program was getting started and there was, you know, there was even things like Echo and Sputnik. And so that didn't, obviously, if that didn't make me go with correlated electrons, but at a very young age, I was bit by the science bug. And the path to get to where I am in this field is just like you try this and you get excited by this, and that's what gets you there. And I just got addicted. I like to say about science, it's addictive and consuming. And so once you get bit by the science bug, you're kind of stuck. Mm-hmm. And you can't really get away from it, and I just
love it. So you got bit by the science bug on your own. It's not like somebody else actually said, oh, Laura, maybe this is something that you should try.
Not at all. Just completely on my own. In elementary school, they didn't know what to do with me. And,
I
went through the science books, and they gave me Mrs. Picklewiggle, which I loved, but, you know, and I did take a summer science course, and I was the only girl in it, and my mother was a little shocked. But, you know, it's what I like to do, you know.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
That's fascinating. So, you know, I mean, you have had quite a ride, right? I mean, you are right now the president of APS. You are the chief scientist of the National High Magnetic Lab. You know, you're a member of the National Academy. I mean, I can keep going on and on and on. How do you think the ride has been overall, though?
Terrific.
Going from the beginning?
Terrific. Yeah, so the other thing, which is absolutely true, is, you know, I never thought I'd get a job doing physics. I just never thought I would be that lucky. I figured I would end up doing something else. I didn't know what. In graduate school, I thought, wow, I really like machining. Maybe I'll be a machinist, because I never really thought I'd have a job doing this.
So where did you go to graduate school?
Cornell.
Okay.
I started at Ohio State, then I transferred to Cornell. And so, you know, in working on all this stuff, I just felt that every day I had being in science, and particularly physics, was just a lucky day. And I thought, if I'm really lucky, maybe I will get a job, maybe teaching somewhere, maybe working in a laboratory, and maybe every few years I would go to a conference or something. But I never expected this kind of life, and it's just been fabulous. It's wonderful meeting people all over the world and interacting and, you know, the diversity aspect of physics, because it's so international. People with very different backgrounds
whether it's chemistry and physics or a whole different country where you're raised with a different kind of education or a different background, helps you look at problems differently and helps you crack the problems. And I just find that very exciting.
Wonderful. That's fascinating. So, you know, after that, you have also been at Bell Labs, then you went to Urbana-Champaign, and you were there for a long time over there before you moved to Florida State and the National High Magnetic Field Lab. Can you tell us about some of the most rewarding experiences that you've had, or like the moments that you really cherished?
There's so many
to recount. Just tell us about a couple.
There's so many, so that people can get some ideas. Science-wise, I think there are a couple of things. Like, I'll just think of one that started. I think I was at Urbana already. So we were doing a lot of work on the high TC, and we figured out a lot of what was going on inside the lattice. And then there were some predictions that we went after, and that's when we really discovered the Andreev bound states and the time reversal symmetry breaking and then high temperature superconductors. And that was kind of a long battle because I spent years learning how to grow the materials to make the measurements, and it was difficult to repeat, and it's been repeated, and we understand the whole thing now, and it's a solved problem. But, you know, there was something that seeing it, knowing I was the only one that saw it at the time, and really having to learn to understand it, having to learn some field theory, and the, you know, it was just really exciting to really get into the depth of it. But there's so many other things. I mean, even past the science, the work that we've done on heavy fermions and recently samarium hexaboride, just using these measurement techniques to look at really complex materials and just learning a little more and more. But the other rewarding things is getting to know the people, working with people all over the world. I've been involved with the COACH program, which is working mostly with young women all over the world in career development, advice and publishing in peer-reviewed journals, mentoring, writing proposals, and learning from each other when we do these things. I don't know what to say, just the breadth of the physics and the collaborations and the people I've met has just been terrific. Besides the science, just keeping you going.
Makes perfect sense. I mean, yeah. This is amazing. So the other thing that we were wondering was if you can tell us something about what kinds of obstacles you might have encountered along the way. I mean, just so that people
know.
Being a physicist can be a difficult thing.
Physics is hard. Physics is really hard. I mean,
Things don't work all the time, right?
It doesn't work. I mean, I was doing planar tunneling for many, many years, and it could take you 2 or 3 years to learn how to make a reliable junction. And it's really hard, and then understanding it. And physicists tend to be a little bit full of themselves, so you always feel like you're the one that doesn't understand it, even taking the courses. And so it's really tough on your ego.
So are you saying that you have to be patient and you have to just keep going?
You have to just keep going and remind yourself of certain rites of passages. What got you into it in the beginning? It's like a marriage, right? So you're looking at your spouse and you're really angry, but if you remember the wedding, that'll help you get through it. So if I remember the certain things that really drove me, that when I really understood what was going on in certain things and in materials and certain discoveries that happened, and not even my own discoveries, you know, other people's discoveries that I always called the flathead discoveries, why didn't I do that? They keep you going. They're just really exciting. I read other people's work and I just am impressed, and I love it. And as far as obstacles, we're always going to have obstacles. Did I have obstacles because I was female? At this age, yes, of course.
Actually, I was going to ask you that, you know, have you encountered any gender bias?
Yes, of course, all kinds of it. And that's why you have your girlfriends and you think you're going crazy and you're told for the 47,000th time you got your job because you're a woman. And it does tend to wear on you a little bit, but you have to kind of remind yourself and keep in touch with your friends and your girlfriends especially, that we all get this. And, you know, even if it's true, you know, people get jobs because they play golf with certain people and things like that. So I think not much of that is very true, and the statistics really show that that's not really the case. Oh, just because they were female, they got it. But I think, you know, people have ego problems and they want to say those things, and you have to just kind of interact and be positive about it
and you can be, and it helps you build an inner strength. And every time you run into one of these barriers, and actually being female is nice because you talk with your girlfriends about it, and then you can build on it. And if you run into another one, you can build on that. And it kind of helps you build, and it helps other people. And things are getting better. Things are getting better, and you know, working on it. So
a related question, what advice would you give to students who want to be like you, especially like women?
The first thing is don't be too hard on yourself, right? I mean, that was one of my problems. I would see this person was better at the math, that person was better at building electronic boxes, that person caught on to things faster. And, you know, just look at the whole, if you love it, stay with it. Another thing is keep your girlfriends, because my analogy I always like to say is that when you feel like you're going crazy, because you are, this is probably true for anybody that's a minority, just you get in touch with your friends, and now we don't have time for phone calls, it's going to be through email or whatever, and you listen to your friend, you give them a hug electronically, and then you turn them around and push them back out there. So that's all good advice, just stay in contact, and when things really seem tough, get in touch with your friends and try to remember why you got into the first time, in the first place. When you get overwhelmed with maybe administration, writing proposals or whatever, kind of make sure you segment some time every week. I try to delineate a day that I'm not teaching, a few hours where I only don't do email, just think physics, read about physics, and enlighten yourself. And you know, that is such a joy. And that can really keep you going.
So. Wow, those are great advice. So the other thing that I was wondering was, do you think you have any advice in terms of what people should know? Like in retrospect, you must know some things about, you know, how, what you could have done, maybe if you had known something in grad school or in an industry once you went there or when you were a faculty because you know sometimes you say, oh, I found out this thing later, right? I mean, if I had known these things, I could have planned things in a slightly different way. So what are the kinds of things that you feel
I think you
could have done better?
I think
with?
You need to ask other people that question, because I don't have an answer for that. To me it was like on a roller coaster going near light speed with my eyes wide open while I'm standing up. And I don't know what I planned. I did the best I could to maximize my time doing physics, mm-hmm. and to enjoy my interactions with people and to learn every time I could. And I love the teaching. I love having students in my laboratory. And keep an open mind. Don't blame when things go awry. Don't take it personally. I think that's the most important.
Okay.
Women tend to take things personally.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're at a conference and people are, you're really fighting with each other, it's not about you. It's never about you. And I've had all kinds of discussions, and you know, when you're in a discussion with a Russian physicist, their style will be to personally attack you.
So you're saying never take things personally.
Don't take it personally. And, you know, I was having a discussion with Alexei Abrakosov, and I was starting to win. And he said, you know, women do not think logically. And I had learned something from Lev Gorkov, who unfortunately just passed away, who was a wonderful, wonderful person, besides a great physicist. I watched him have an argument with Jalasinski at a meeting. And Jalasinski was yelling at him. And Lev says, excuse me. And Jalasinski was still arguing why I can't use Fermi liquid theory or something. And Lev goes, nevertheless, and went on. So that's my technique. If I start getting attacked, mm-hmm. I say, excuse me. If they continue, I say, nevertheless, and I go on. And I found, so that's a little technique that I've learned that I found very useful. So, and again, you know, my theme for my presidential year is science diplomacy. And science diplomacy really means that, you know, just like we all worry about our families, we all want better lives, and as scientists, we're all on the same side.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter if you're doing nuclear, high energy, or, you know, social sciences. any of those things. We're all on the same side. And even if we want to argue about data or whatever, and we can have extremely heated arguments, we're still all on the same side. And that's the link that we have for real communication across the planet and in the United States when people are so disparate right now in some of their beliefs.
I so agree with you. I mean, that makes perfect sense. So what's your thought on, you know, graduate students, for example, who are pursuing PhD in physics? Should they be basically doing everything together? Like, from what I understand, you're saying you should be living your life and doing your work. I mean, like, it should all be well integrated, right? It shouldn't be that, oh, let's put our life on hold or something like that. What's your thought on, because, you know, sometimes people say, no, when I'm a graduate student, I cannot do anything. Do you have any thoughts on?
Now, I'll tell you, this is, again, a very personal decision. So when I am with Jerry Richmond and we do these coach lectures, we are completely different. She has this great life-family balance, and it all works out, and this time is with family, and this time is with it. With me, it's all kind of, I used to call it a semi-controlled crash, and I'm not even sure the word semi-control works anymore, but it works, right? When my kids need me, I'm there. When family needs me, I'm there. My work, and I just, to me, it's kind of a random existence. And that's my personal choice. And other
of work-life balance.
Of work-life balance. I have no work-life balance. And that works for me.
Well, you have it perfectly.
Well,
you know, I mean, the way I look at it, it looks like you have a perfect balance, Laura.
Well, but the way I live my life is not going to work the way another person lives their life. And it's something that, you know, I will share with you how I live my life. I have no secrets, unfortunately. And so I'm happy to share everything. And we like to talk about how we do this, quote, work-life balance. And if you talk with 35 physicists, you will get 75 different ways of how this is done. And it's good to hear other people's views on how they do it and make the decision what's best for you, your surroundings, your family, your job. And I will also say, I just want to fold into there, is that don't be afraid to negotiate. So if your professor mm-hmm. says our group meetings are 6 to 8 o'clock at night and you have kids at home, you start that negotiation, and don't and this is something that I actually give lectures on, and I think you do also, and it's not just saying, I can't do it, you have to change it. It's like, let's start negotiating and make this thing more family friendly and just work things out. And so in working these out, don't just accept everything. Have a voice and say, you know, this isn't working for my family or for my work. Tell your family, you negotiate with your family or your friends or your job or whatever, and you just have to find a way to work it out. If nobody's right, you just have to find a way to work it out. Well, sometimes somebody's wrong, but yeah.
Right, so you're saying that it's a good idea to actually make sure that all of the different components of your life work out together, as opposed to putting up with something that is not working for
yeah.
your family, for example.
And once in a while, you may have to just close down and put up with something that's really bad. But you know, that shouldn't happen too often. You should really keep in mind that everything's negotiable. Everything's negotiable. And in the old days, I didn't feel I could negotiate, a long, long time ago. And anything, I just totally capitulated to everything. And it wasn't until I grew up a little bit and got more confidence that I realized, you know, what happened is I saw the younger women do this. So when I got to graduate school, there were so few women. There were like three of us. And then the years that I was at Cornell, a lot more women came in. And by then, women's lib was sort of happening. And I learned from them. I learned from people like Sandra Troyan, who totally taught me how to negotiate in certain areas. And it's just been marvelous to learn from everybody. So
if, you know, regarding graduate students, I mean, do you have any advice on how they should be selecting an advisor, PhD advisor? What are the important components?
That one I do have advice on.
Okay.
So that was advice given to one of my mentors, Jim Garland, when I got to Ohio State. I go, I don't know. This is for graduate school. I go, oh, I don't know what I'm doing. doing? This high energy is so cool, and nuclear and solid state physics, and oh, I love electrical engineering, and I just, I couldn't get enough of it. It was all like a candy store, and do I want the chocolate or vanilla or the Smarties or whatever? And he gave me some advice that shocked me, and I realized it was right, which was go around and visit the groups and see who you're most comfortable with. And my first reaction was, that's insane. I should choose it by the physics. But, you know, it turns out what I've learned through the years is that condensed matter physicists who are doing strongly correlated electrons really have a slightly different outlook on life than high energy people, than soft matter, than biological physics people. And for some reason, you do kind of flop down on approaches in the same way. And I don't know why that works, but that did help me choose an advisor. Meet the people, meet the students, meet the advisor, and see where you think you're going to be comfortable working. Because frankly, I would be happy working on any of these problems. You know, that's why I wanted to be in industry. Because in industry, you get this variety of problems that you're told to work on, and I was happy working on anything. And so, so I think that's sort of the advice, is where are you most comfortable?
So since you have actually worked in an industry and at universities, what do you have to say about, like, what are the similarities and differences between, and the pros and cons of working in each of these areas?
Well, I really aim towards industrial physics. That's really what I wanted to do. And again, because I didn't fit, I just had the feeling that if you have some really deep driving problems, you know, whether it's correlated electrons, the Higgs boson, gravity waves, or whatever it was, you really had to be in university. But like I said, I was happy working on any kind of problem. And I loved doing industrial physics.
So what aspects did you like then, Laura?
Oh, that Alex Kosalski would walk into my laboratory and say, hey, you're doing superconductivity. I can understand Schottky barriers with you. Turned out to be a marvelous collaboration. Jean-Marie Tarascon, who's now a very famous battery guy in France, we were working on some stuff, and he's a chemist and I'm a physicist, and we started working out with a graduate student on Travell phases. So we're in a great place to be for high.
So you're saying that in an industry, people are not in silos?
Not at all. It's just working across and new ideas. And then it's kind of exciting to have the short time scales, and you have to worry about the packaging. And I was working in a very industrial laboratory in the electron dynamics division at Hughes Aircraft many years ago, and it wasn't research at all, but I did have kind of a research, and I loved it. And then when a whole bunch of us left Bellcore, which actually fell apart before Bell Labs did, so a whole bunch of us left at the same time, we stayed in contact, and my favorite saying is that...
And that's when you went to Urbana-Champaign.
That's when I went to Urbana-Champaign. Mm-hmm. And my favorite statement was, the Venn diagram overlap of the two jobs was measure zero.
Wow.
It was completely different. When I was at the industry, I had a month at a glance calendar. When I got to the university, that wasn't going to work, because now my days were broken into 15-minute segments. I had to learn to delineate, like I mentioned, research time. You know, and you just have to learn to prioritize. And the other statement that I think Charlie Falco told me was, okay, Laura, congratulations on your job in industry. I bet up until now you thought every job worth doing was worth doing well. Well, forget that one. It's not possible. You know, you have to.
What does that mean?
It means you can't do a perfect job on every committee. You can't do a perfect job in teaching, perfect job in research, perfect job in, you know, it's just so multifaceted.
At the university.
And so I love teaching, and I know the difference between being a good teacher and a truly great teacher is not the time I have. So you have to make a decision. I'm a good teacher. Am I going to win any international awards for teaching? Never. But we work together, and I put my priorities in other places, and you figure it out. But then at a university, one of the beautiful things is you do have people that want to put all their efforts into being a great teacher. And if your research isn't going well and you feel like doing administrative for a while, you have these options. So a university is nice and you have different kinds of options, but they're very, very different jobs. And I can't tell you which one is better. I still kind of lean toward, I really did like industrial research, but
I love being at the university, and I love the Mag Lab is sort of a mix because it's a national
That's
laboratory.
True.
So I don't know. I just feel so lucky that I'm paid to do science. You know, so it's a dream come true. So
that's a very important aspect of what we do, right? That we get paid to do fun stuff.
Right, right, right. Yeah, really do.
So that's a real advantage.
Yeah, we get paid to think about what LIGO means, you know, even though that's not my job. I mean, the talk I'm going to give later today will be some similarities between LIGO and techniques that we've learned in correlated electrons. You know, there's so many similarities and there's so much excitement between the areas. It's just fun to think about. And I think you learn that way. I think you correct problems that way.
That's great. So, you know, Laura, you have yourself been such a great role model to me, and so I'm just wondering, like, if you have had role models.
Many. I mentioned this, one of my mentors early on was Jim Garland, and he was my undergraduate advisor, and for some reason, even all those years ago, he was still worried about diversity in physics, and he's been a friend and a role model and a mentor, David Tanner, Charlie Ebner, and of course, we just lost Millie Dresselhaus. And Millie is a role model, but she just walked on water. I mean, she's a role model to a level that I could never attain. So she's like a very high role model, but I was lucky to spend a lot of time with her, especially last year. We were on several committees together. And she wanted to give me advice about, she was an earlier president of the American Physical Society, and she gave me a lot of advice. And there's so many role models out there. I don't even know where to start. I mean, just even my best friend from graduate school, Marilyn Schneider, who's working at NIF right now, she's my age, and she's a role model. And these aren't just role models in science. I mean, Marilyn decided to cut back on her science to spend more time on, I mean, she's still doing great science, but just instead of being frontline, to spend more time with her family. And I have so much respect for her for doing that, because that's right for her. So just being able to choose what you want to do is, to me, important. And those people that can do that are role models.
Absolutely. No, I totally agree. So my last question would be, so what do you have to say to students who are wanting to do physics in terms of what the future looks like for physics?
Gosh, where's my crystal ball? I don't know what the future's going to bring, except that everything's been accelerating so fast in sciences. You know, I'm always fond of saying, see this mobile phone, the cell phone. 25 years ago, most of those materials didn't even exist. It probably has more computing power than MIT had 30 years ago. And in fact, the GPS in there would not have worked without Einstein's general theory of relativity. And you know, we have all these standard statements that we do. But it's moved so fast, even in the years I've been doing physics. I really can't tell the future, except that I think it will keep accelerating. There's so many things we need to do with our growing population, climate problems, water resources. I have to believe that putting our efforts into science is all kinds of broad areas of science, you know, the humanitarian sciences, the physical sciences, the biological sciences, and the arts. I have to also put that in. As a humanity, we have to keep doing this. We're going to be met with some very serious challenges in the 21st century. And I think involving scientists on a global scale will certainly help us out. And so if you want to do science, you go for it. And look at me. I mean, I never thought I'd get a job in it. It was like a calling. It's like being called to the priesthood or something. And I got lucky. I'm still in it. And there's a chance for everybody. Just stay with it. And if you don't end up in science, the education that you receive by being, especially in physics, because that's the myopic area I know.
It's going to be very valuable.
It's valuable if you're going to be an insurance salesman. You know, it's just, it's a really valuable way to look at anything and apply scientific method. You know, any aspect of life, even raising children, I think scientific method is going to help you out. And it's,
So yeah, so my advice is, if you want to do it at all, go for it. It's a hell of a lot of fun. And if you are running into problems, call me at Laura H. Greene.
Well, thank you so much, Laura. That, you know, that's a great advice. I think, you know, all of the things that you've said will be very valuable.
Well,
thanks,
I hope
Laura.
So.
Thanks
and
so
thank
much.
You for having me here. It's just
well,
really great
so
to
much.
See you
it's
and the whole Institute.
Always great to have you. And, you know, as I said, you're personally a great role model to me. Oh. So.
Well, thank you very much.
It's
and you to
wonderful
me.
Wonderful to have you here. Thank you, Laura.
Thank you.